The Premier has used his second state budget as Treasurer to announce WA will record a massive $5.7 billion surplus. But as living costs continue to force many West Australians to make tough decisions, there are growing calls for the government to share that eye-watering wealth. Natalie Forrest is covering the budget for us tonight and joins us live from Parliament. Nat, tell us, what is in this year's budget for families?
Lachlan, the Premier will provide some cost of living relief for households. There is a $400 credit to reduce power bills, but that is just a one-off sugar hit. He has stopped short of freezing household fees and charges, which welfare groups and charities had been calling for, despite announcing that massive surplus. A spring in his step despite the miserable weather. The Premier buoyed by a better-than-expected budget bottom line.
This is another strong budget that helps set Western Australia up for a bright future beyond the pandemic.
Strong iron ore prices resulting in a $5.7 billion surplus, almost double what was predicted. But that will fall to $1.6 billion next financial year, while net debt will drop below $30 billion.
With the strongest domestic growth in the nation, across the pandemic.
The centrepiece of the self-appointed Treasurer's second budget, cost of living relief, offering a one-off $400 credit to households to reduce their power bills at a cost of $445 million.
The credit will kick in July. It basically means for your average household, it will be nearly 3 months without having to pay for electricity.
While concession card holders will get an additional $318 energy assistance payment, but other fees and charges will rise an average 2.5%.
Well, the opposition called for the freezing of government fees and charges. It's one of the things we thought would ease the pressure for West Australian households struggling to make ends meet. They haven't done this.
By far the biggest spend, a record $33.9 billion on infrastructure, $6 billion of that for Metronet, while another $1.6 billion allocated for the state's COVID response and a record $2.5 billion to try to revive our flatlining health system. But with record ambulance ramping, bed blockage and staff shortages, don't expect relief anytime soon.
There's no overnight fixes here because of the COVID environment we're in, but we're certainly leaving no stone unturned.
I don't think there'll be a short-term impact from this funding. Unfortunately, where the medical system is right now is reflective of a lack of funding over the last 5 years.
As the Premier gloats at WA's financial position compared with the other states.
I suspect they'll be green with envy. Some of them will look like they swallowed a bumblebee.
And Treasurer Mark McGowan joins me live now. Premier, that $400 electricity credit that's there, Treasury's own figures are saying that year on year electricity prices have grown by 116.7%. Is that $400 really going to do much, or is it going to be eaten up straight away?
Well, the $400 goes on everyone's electricity account. So wherever you live in Western Australia, you will get $400 worth of free electricity from July onwards. So for many families, that's 2 or 3 months of their electricity bills. So it is a real benefit to people across Western Australia. And in overall terms, the price of state government services across the board, whether it's water, power and all those sorts of things, will actually go down by 3.8%. So we're one of the only organisations in the state, perhaps the country, that's actually putting prices down.
Our hospitals are in crisis. You've increased the spending there and you've announced 500 beds, but most of those won't come online till after winter. Have you left it too little, too late?
Well, since last budget and including this budget, there's $5.7 billion of additional spend on health and mental health. That's 530 beds, 340 of them are already online, so the others are coming online over the next few months towards October. And that will mean significant improvement in our health services. But dealing with COVID, people absent from work is difficult. We're doing our best, and our hospitals and nurses and staff are doing their best in a difficult situation.
Now, net debt is down under $30 billion, but over the next 4 years up until 2026, it's going to rise by another $4 billion. While iron ore prices are high, why aren't we paying off more?
Well, we're the only government in Australia paying off debt, and we're reducing it down by $14 billion on what the projections were under the last government that we inherited the debt levels from. So it's a third of the debt paid off by this government. only government in Australia doing it, and what it does is reduce our interest payments. I mean, we don't have to borrow for things like the electricity credit, and it also ensures that we don't leave a debt burden for future generations.
Premier, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Natalie.
Now, with the economy thriving, the problem is that real wages are going backwards. Now, the government is standing firm on a 2.75% increase, but that is seeing families falling further behind.
WA's economy is thriving and unemployment is at a 13-year low 3.5%. Despite the state's envious set of books, the Premier's rejected calls to improve his government's strict wages policy.
This is a budget that fails public sector workers.
Maximum increases of 2.75% simply won't be enough to see public sector workers through and to enable them to meet the cost of living.
While economists praise the Premier for holding firm,
we're already seeing that wages burden increase over the forward estimates up to $17 billion.
It's left some unions threatening industrial action.
That we're not going to need to. We're leaving in droves. Our members are leaving in droves.
Our members too are leaving the force in considerable high numbers. We've had 164 leave since the 1st of January of this year.
And although the $400 power credit handout is welcome relief for most WA families, it may be quickly chewed up by Australia's rampant inflation, which is expected to rise another 2.5% next year.
And the fact that they can pay next month's electricity bill, great, thank you. The one after that, the one after that, and the one after that, nothing.
Over the next 4 years, $9 billion will be spent upgrading our roads, $106 million to improve policing and community safety, while an additional $1.3 billion has been allocated to water down the state's reliance on mining, including an extra $80 million to attract new industries to WA.
I think we could still do more on diversification, particularly in attracting and building up new industries here, allowing them to scale up and stay in WA.
Nathan Brooks for 10 News First.
And the Shadow Treasurer, Steve Thomas, joins me now. Steve, there's a big surplus. There was some cost of living relief there. What did you make of the budget?
Well, another very big surplus, Nat. I mean, I appreciate and welcome the cost of living stuff that has been announced. $400 per household is good, but it's a very small step in a very big surplus. And what's missing from the budget is the vision for the future. There's no economic reform, there's no taxation reform, and there's no real reduction in debt. And those are the things that should have happened when you've got the biggest surpluses and the biggest boom in the history of Australia.
There was record spending on infrastructure, nearly $34 billion. Obviously, that's going to be good for the economy. Can we handle it?
No, we can't handle it, and that's part of the problem. The McGowan government has put forward $8 to $9 billion worth of infrastructure over the next 4 years. They've never been able to deliver more than $5 to $6 billion worth. That's because we've got a shortage of workers, a shortage of materials, and they're in competition with the private sector. I mean, there's a reason why it takes 2 to 2.5 years to get a house built now, because those people buying houses are competing with the McGowan government for those things, workers and materials.
Obviously, we've got net debt down under $30 billion. That's good news. You're calling for more to be paid down, but obviously we need to spend some of that money to keep the economy going and help families. What do you make of that?
Well, Nat, that's right. So we need to spend some money to support families. We need to spend some money to diversify the economy and look at taxes. And we need to spend more money to take down debt. All of those things can fit, you know, the massive budget surpluses that this government has got. They're looking at $20-plus billion worth of surpluses over the next 5 years. Now, Mark McGowan promised in 2017 that he would put half of iron ore royalties into the debt reduction account. If he had lived up to that promise and kept his word, there would be $14 billion less in debt, because the boom has been a $28 billion boom in iron ore royalties. So we're not seeing debt go down. Mark McGowan inherited $32.6 billion worth of debt. And by 2025, according to his own budget, there will be $32 billion worth of debt. He's dropped debt by $0.6 billion over 8 years. At that rate, it will take 100 years to pay off the debt of this state.
Shadow Treasurer Steve Thomas, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Nat.
Obviously, Lachlan, there you can see there are some budget winners and losers, but of course the economy is going strong.
Definitely sounds like it. Nat Forrest, live from Parliament. Great work tonight. Thank you very much.